Hello, it's Sarah Jane with you for a final episode, trying to find some fixes for the NHS, especially in the places we're most familiar with. We've explored emergency care, cancer care, and mental health so far. You can scroll back to listen to those episodes in our feed. This time, we're talking about public health, the health of the population. Sir David Nicholson, who used to run the NHS in England, is back once again. And we should start with a definition, David.
It is anything, any interventions, any surveillance that affects, improves the health of the population. Although public health is based in the Department of Health, Chris Whitty, the chief medical officer, they are responsible for the totality of public health interventions across government. And I think as we have a conversation, we'll see how important that is. It has a proud tradition of intervention going back at least 200 years. If you think about everything from drainage through to the major communicable diseases, smallpox, cholera, all of those things, public health interventions are the things that have probably more than anything improved the health of the entire population.
I've been trying to start each episode just flagging up something you'll learn. I think this time, just hearing about the strain tobacco still causes for the health services is probably what stands out. You'll hear more on that. But let's get a better idea of the challenges from one GP in London.
My name's Dr. Anil Mehta. I'm a GP in the London borough of Redbridge. And I've been a GP at the same practice here for just under 30 years. And I'm also the clinical director of Redbridge as a partnership, which is part of the North East London Integrated Care System. There's a variety of things that I see in general practice, from chronic conditions to the acute conditions. The seasonal respiratory workload is in full flow at the moment, but throughout the sort of working year, I'll see a whole host of long-term conditions, such as diabetes, such as chronic lung disease, things like heart failure, mental health, chronic kidney disease. So those would be the big sort of four or five long-term conditions that I'd see in a lot of my patients.
We've had a lot of patients.
We've had a lot of patients today, a lot of patients coming in for face-to-face appointments, nurse appointments, physio appointments and blood test appointments.
How's the online triage going?
Online triage is full to the brim.
Yeah? Are we up to date with it, though?
Yeah.
Yeah? Good. Okay, thank you.
Poverty in our borough, there's a 1 in 4 ratio of poverty in adults and a 1 in 3 ratio of poverty in children. So that sort of thing has an impact on life expectancy and the kind of diseases and ill health that patients present with to their doctors. So that's something that's probably getting worse, actually, compared to when I started as a GP many, many years ago.
David, how would you sum up the health of the population?
The one that's often used, it's a bit blunt, but nevertheless, which is life expectancy. If you look at life expectancy in this country, it's generally over the last 30 years that's gone up reasonably well, but has essentially plateaued and flatlined during the last 10, 15 years.
There are two kinds of prevention when it comes to public health. And I know you're very keen for people to understand the difference between the two. We talk about primary prevention and secondary prevention.
So primary prevention, in its simplest, is to stop those major diseases that people get across the country, diabetes, heart disease. And then secondary prevention is when you've got those diseases, so type 2 diabetes being the most obvious one and the biggest and probably in some cases the most dangerous one, it's what do you do to prevent the complications of that? That, I think, is really where the NHS comes into its own.
I think it's a good time to bring in Greg Fell. He's Director of Public Health in Sheffield and Chair of the Association of Directors of Public Health. Greg, hello. Where do you think we stand right now as a population on public health?
It is the question that we all hate being asked in the pub. Contrary to popular opinion, we do go to pubs, but covers everything from tobacco, harm from obesity, and David mentioned already type 2 diabetes, harm from alcohol, harm from gambling, right the way through to what folk call the determinants of health, so poor air quality, poor quality housing, which is a big issue at the moment, poverty. Historically, life expectancy has gone up by about 1 year in every 3 or 4. For a long time now, that's largely as a result of historic improvements in air quality. We need to come back to that. Improvements in children's health and well-being, and infant mortality has gone down, and that's a really, really good news story. But, and it's a really important but, for the last 10 years or so, life expectancy is not now going up. It's flatlining. And ditto, healthy life expectancy, how long a baby can expect to live in a state of good health, is also flatlining. And we're a long way from solving the inequality in both life and healthy life expectancy. There's a 20-year gap in Sheffield, and Sheffield's not particularly unusual. So that stalling of historic health improvements is the big story in health policy at the moment, and partly but not wholly explains why the NHS is having some very, very, very significant demand problems at the moment. If I get my job right, we'll be healthier as a result, and as a downstream result of that, there'll be less demand in the NHS.
What would make your job easier? We hear that phrase nanny state whenever the government try to introduce a measure for people to be proactive about their health.
I'll pick alcohol harm. It's probably not quite the new tobacco, but it's a significant cause of harm in the population. And too many people drink too much, probably me included, to be fair. So I'm certainly not being holier than thou in this. So there are a number of ways to approach alcohol-related harm. We can and do provide addiction treatment. The second approach would be to grossly oversimplify it, for me to stand outside the town hall with a megaphone saying, drink less, kids, it's bad for your health. And clearly, that's not going to be terribly effective. That model of health education or improving health literacy, improving people's understanding about the health risks of alcohol, we do a bit of it, but it doesn't work that well. The harm is driven by consumption. Consumption is driven by price, how cheap it is. And there's a reason why alcohol industries invest enormously in alcohol advertising, because it works. It's also increased by availability. The more outlets there are selling cheap alcohol, the higher consumption will be. Therefore, there'll be higher harm. I can address some of those issues locally. Licensing is one tool, but the real business end of that is national regulation of product price, marketing availability, etc. Many will say, well, Greg, that's just the nanny state gone mad. The alcohol industry spends tens of millions of pounds lobbying governments to keep policy away from regulation of product and industry, and spend hundreds of millions of pounds on advertising to influence our choices. So if we're going to have a conversation about nannying, let's have a two-sided conversation. Folks say this is about freedom of choice, and I'm a strong believer in freedom of choice, but end-stage liver disease doesn't give anyone terribly much freedom.
I hate the term nanny state because I think it's a term designed to shut down the argument. If you look historically at tobacco as an example, you know, for years it was a completely unfair fight. You know, the tobacco industry with all its billions fighting against a public health function. But what made the big steps forward were the kind of regulatory things. Smoking in enclosed places, you know, public places, has made a massive impact, not least of all to people's quality of life. I think the announcement the Prime Minister recently made about the age that you can buy tobacco is a massively progressive step and could only be done by regulation. You cannot do that by literally, you know, trying to persuade people.
Calories going on to restaurant menus. There was a bit of uproar about that. It's died down now, and it makes me think about my choices. Don't always go for the healthy one, have to admit. But I make that choice, and I make an informed choice. Where do you think education fits in all of this?
I too see the however many thousand calories are in that enormous slice of chocolate cake and think, no, I'm not going to have that chocolate cake. But my guess is that folk like me, fairly affluent, usually white folk, will be more likely to look at the how many calories are in that chocolate cake, and a very large proportion of the population won't know, won't care, don't bother to look. Thus, having the education in that intervention won't have a great deal of impact. So it's necessary, but it's nowhere near sufficient.
One of the reorganisations in 2010, 2011 was moving public health from the NHS into local government. In lots of ways, a really sensible thing to do, given the responsibilities for the wider term itself, but also given the kind of connection with locality, which sometimes the NHS struggles with from its big hospital ivory tower sort of thing. But the downside of it has been, while the NHS has been protected in terms of funding, although people in the NHS might argue with that, but it has been protected, local government has not been protected. And so the downside of it, I guess, is that public health as a function has come under much more financial pressure. I just wonder, Greg, taking that into account, do you think the move was the right thing and that you can benefit from it?
I'd been an NHS employee for my whole career up until that point, and I thought it was a crazy idea. 10 or so years down the line, I was absolutely wrong on that one, and I've fundamentally changed my worldview. If the purpose of me and my team is to create the conditions that enable health and well-being, then almost all of the functions and responsibilities to do that are within local government, and it makes absolute sense to be at the heart of that. It was set up as a result of an 1875 Public Health Act, which was all about clean water, clean air, drainage systems, parks and green space, and some of those things are quite topical again. But local government was set up because of that. So its core purpose is to create health and well-being of the residents in that particular population. On the money, it's fair to say over the past decade or so, as a result of austerity, local authority spending power is about 50% less than it was. And if you take the argument that one of the purposes of local authorities is to invest in what some folk call the determinants of health, good quality housing, transport system, parks and green space, we're investing less in the things that determine health of populations. That's one of the reasons why life expectancy is flatlining. More parochially to me, the public health budget is 24-25% smaller in cash terms than it was a decade ago. That means less health visitors, less drug and alcohol treatment services, less investment in voluntary and community sector, less investment in sexual health. We're way, way, way beyond the point of efficiency savings now. We're cutting services. That will have consequences.
What would be your priorities for the NHS when it comes to public health? There's so much choice, it'll be hard to choose. But what do you think are the pressing issues?
One, tobacco. People keep telling me X is the new smoking. No, tobacco is still the new tobacco. Help us with the societal effort to push really hard to get smoking prevalence as low as it can go. It's probably the chief health risk at the moment. The second one is more prosaic, but primary care, i.e. GPs, community pharmacy, community dentistry and optometry. It's the demand management bit of the NHS and what primary care clinicians, particularly GPs, but not just GPs, are really good at is seeing whole people, whole patients, whole populations, medical care from birth to death. Primary care is enormously impactful on the health of populations. It's enormously impactful on providing good quality care to Mrs. Smith at number 44, who doesn't have one thing wrong with her type 2 diabetes. She has five things wrong with her all at once. That needs generalist medical care, and primary care in this country is strong but a bit fragile. And it's the thing that, with regard to NHS policy, it's the thing that worries me most. So all we can do to bolster the sustainability of and the capacity of primary care is my chief NHS-oriented priority. I'll probably oversimplify it a little bit, but the pound per head of population to deliver primary care is equal across Sheffield, but need is very much greater in the east of Sheffield than the west of Sheffield. And GPs in the west of Sheffield will say to me, but we've lots of frail people who are very demanding on healthcare, to which I say to those GPs, there are equally frail people in the east of Sheffield, but they're just 30 years younger. The demand is much higher in the east of Sheffield. So we need, if we're going to really address inequalities, then we need to address the resource provision to be attuned to that. And that requires some bravery and requires choices and trade-offs.
Okay, Greg, we'll pause there. In a moment, how do you work out if the public's health is actually improving? Let's talk about cause for optimism in public health.
I am optimistic. Despite there are some issues and problems, we've talked about those, despite all of that, the public health profession and the public health system is in a reasonably strong position. One example I frequently use is infant mortality. Babies that die before their first birthday, one can only imagine how traumatic and difficult that is. It's the peak indicator for the health of children and young people more broadly. If you get that right, you're very likely to be getting lots of other things right. A decade ago, Sheffield wasn't doing terribly well. To be blunt, our infant mortality rates were very high, much higher than the core cities, much higher than the England average, and we decided that wasn't good enough. We drafted our infant mortality strategy. There are eight programs of work within that strategy, and we basically doggedly implemented those over a decade. In that decade, we halved infant mortality. And that didn't happen by magic. It happened because a lot of people worked really hard, doggedly, over a long period to make that happen. How do we know we've been successful? when nothing happens, and that's part of the problem in public health. If we're all about preventing things, it's kind of hard to count the fruits of prevention because nothing happens. It's like the dog that doesn't bark. You don't know it's there. But that's how we do success.
The potential policy, the potential interventions are all there. But as Greg says, the important bit then is the dogged way in which you make it happen over several years. If you want to change the health of the population, you can't do it by sign bite, by press release, by, you know, clever speech. It's actually hard graft at the front line. That's the way we'll make the change. I don't think we've ever been in a better place in terms of either the information and evidence that we have that what works, but also the kind of people in place to make it happen.
I'd not been in central London for about 5 or 6 years, and I was in central London a couple of weeks ago. I was astounded by how much less traffic there was and how many more people were walking and cycling. Air quality is a killer. It's a silent killer. You can't see it. You can sometimes smell it. It stunts children's lungs and it causes heart attacks and strokes. Air quality stats in London have gone down and congestion in London has gone down. That, again, hasn't happened by magic. It has happened because transport professionals, air quality professionals have held their nerve and built the right infrastructure to enable that to happen and held their nerve against people who were grumbling to London Mayor and probably plenty of other people. And what those air quality professionals have done in London, they have saved lives. No, zero doubt about the fact they've saved lives. They'll never be able to see it, count it, because you're back to the dog that doesn't bark. Public health is done not only by folk who've got the word public and health in their job title, but a whole bunch of other professionals from all sorts of walks of life across the whole of government.
I think you put it so well in terms of success is where nothing happens. David, we've come to the end of our series, and of course there's only so much we can cover in a mini series about how to fix the NHS. I think we've done a good job of getting through a number of issues on a number of topics. And what struck me is the level of optimism, the number of solutions being offered.
I think in all of the editions here, you have seen people coming forward with a set of ideas that would improve things. Some of them would cost some money, some of them would cost nothing. That's really encouraging because there's nothing worse than facing a problem and not knowing what to do. So we know what to do. Secondly, I think a determination to make things happen and having a longer time scale than just 3 months or 6 months or even a year, sometimes several years to get the right outcomes. And the third thing is the inspiring people that we have, enabling them to get on and do these things, I think is the most optimistic thing.
Well, David, it's been a pleasure to get your insight over the course of this series, How to Fix the NHS. As one of our guests said, it's tough out there, but there are brilliant people doing a brilliant job. And there are learnings to be taken from everything we've heard, everything that's being done. And now it's over to government. You know, we want to take the politics out of it in a sense, but it is over to government to enable those people to carry on their good work and take it further. David, thank you so much.
Thank you.
We got in touch with the Department of Health and Social Care and NHS England to get their reaction to some of the points that have been made across this mini-series on how to fix the NHS. We'll give you an update when they come back to us. Hopefully, these four episodes have taught you something about the challenges facing the National Health Service, but also some things that are actually happening, could happen, to help the service in the future. Well, that's it for this Sky News Daily mini-series, How to Fix the NHS. Scroll back in the feed for the other episodes. Thanks for listening.